Welcome to this DVD on the installation process for the Centurion D3 and D5 sliding gate operators. This program is designed to supplement the installation manual in your kit, but does not replace it. If you want more information on a particular section of the installation, please pause your DVD and the page number that appears in the bottom corner of your screen will show you which page you need to look at in the manual. Part 1, the pre-inspection. Before you begin the operator installation, make sure your gate is mechanically safe and ready to be automated. The gate must move freely. Check the pull force. For the D3, this must be less than 12 kilograms force, and for the D5, less than 20 kilograms force. The weight of the gate must also be within the limits of the operator. The D3 can handle up to 300 kilograms and the D5, 500 kilograms. Guide rollers must be securely fitted and correctly aligned so the gate can't fall over. For proper security, ensure that an anti-lift bracket is fitted. It is typically located in line with the motor and must prevent the closed gate from being lifted by more than 5 millimeters. The gate must slide easily into an end catch bracket. The catch bracket must also prevent the front of the gate from being lifted off the rail. A sturdy end stop must be fitted to the rail to prevent the gate running back too far. Depending on where the operator will be positioned, the gate might need an extension to which the rack can be fitted so it still engages with the operator pinion. Plan where you're going to put the gate operator and ensure that no underground pipes or electrical cables are in the way. Make sure there's sufficient drainage where the operator will stand so it doesn't get flooded. Please take note of all other site considerations and warnings provided in the manual. Part 2, cabling. Before you proceed with the mounting of the operator itself, it's important to decide what cables you need and lay these first. The first cable will be for the 220-volt main supply between the house and the gate operator. A double pole isolator must be fitted on this cable within 1 meter reach of the operator. In addition, this main supply must be fed via its own circuit breaker from the mains distribution board inside the house. It's always recommended to have the main supply to the operator installed by a qualified electrician. If you are fitting an intercom and plan to trigger the operator from their handset inside the house, you will also need to install these cables. One cable running from the house to the operator and another from the operator to the intercom entry panel on the outside of the property. Allow for extra cores inside this cable so that you can make use of the useful features supported by the D3 and D5 operators, such as pedestrian opening, holiday lockout, gate status LED, etc. Although the radio receiver can be mounted inside the operator, for optimum range it is suggested you mount this externally and as high as possible. An extra cable will be required for this. It is highly recommended that you fit infrared safety beams to the system, in which case you will need to allow for cabling to be routed from the operator to both sides of the driveway. If you want to operate the pedestrian opening feature at the gate, a separate cable will be needed between the operator and a key switch, or preferably a keypad. If a pedestrian has to reach their hand through the gate to operate the key switch or keypad, it must always be mounted on the opposite side of the driveway to the operator. Refer to the cabling requirements section of the manual for full details on the cabling required. With all cabling, screened cables are a good idea as they give better protection against lightning. Make sure that all screened cables are securely tied to earth. Refer to the section later in this DVD that discusses lightning protection. Part 3, the foundations. The base plate must be positioned flush with the driveway entrance and not protrude into the driveway where a car could hit it. Don't mount the operator too close to the side of a gate support post or pillar, as you need some space on the side of the operator to access the mounting studs. If you're going to fit a theft-resistant cage, also bear in mind the space required for this. The base plate can be either bolted down onto an existing concrete plinth or concreted into position. Assemble the base plate, fitting the concrete anchor tabs where necessary, and ensure that the studs are thoroughly tightened. The gearbox must be positioned so that when it stands 5 mm off the base plate and the rack is 3 mm above the pinion, the rack can be fixed to the bottom of the gate. Now prepare a hole for the foundation of approximately 400 mm square by 300 mm deep. Check what type of soil you have. If it's loose sandy soil, you may need to make a larger foundation. A good tip when using a concrete foundation is to weld the base plate to the track using short lengths of angle iron. This will allow you to complete the installation of the operator, commission the unit, and only then finish off by throwing the concrete plinth. Route your cables through the cable entry hole, allowing at least 400 mm to protrude above the base plate. Part 4, Earthing and Lightning Protection. The surge protection provided by the unit relies on an effective earth. Besides ensuring that the main supply is properly earthed back at the distribution board, also tie the earth of the power supply and controller to the base plate. To improve the earthing at the operator, install an earth spike right next to the operator and connect this firmly to the base plate. If you are using a copper-plated steel rod, you can hammer it through the plate as shown and weld it to the plate to ensure an excellent earth. In areas of high lightning, an additional high current arrestor can be placed on the mains ahead of the charger. The surge arrestor's earth must be well secured to the operator earth. As mentioned previously, all cabling should be screened to give better protection against lightning. Part 5, mounting the operator and rack. To mount the operator, first fit the M10 nuts and washers onto the base plate. We set the height of the nuts to be 7 mm clear of the base to allow for later adjustment. Don't forget the washers. Now remove the cable entry knockouts from the operator. Feed your cables through these holes and lower the operator into position. Secure the operator in place using the flat washers, spring washers, and nuts supplied. The D5 is shipped without oil in the gearbox, so if you're fitting a D5, fill the gearbox now. This is not necessary with the D3 as it uses grease in its gearbox. We will now show you how to mount both Centurion Nylon RAS rack and ordinary steel rack. This is probably the most difficult part of the installation, so care must be taken to do this section properly. The rack must be mounted, centered on the pinion, with a 2 to 3 mm gap between the teeth of the pinion and the teeth of the rack along its entire length. To assist in achieving the correct tooth gap, our installation hint is to raise the operator by an additional 3 mm, approximately 3 turns of the nut. Put the operator into manual override so that the pinion can be turned by hand. We do this by rotating the thumb wheel fully clockwise until the gearbox disengages. The nylon RAS rack is screwed onto the side of the gate using the self-drilling and tapping Tech screws provided. You can purchase from any hardware store a very convenient socket tool that fits into the chuck of your drill. The tip of the tool is magnetized so that it grips the screw and allows for very easy fitment. We always mount the rack starting from the right-hand side of the gate, working to the left. Do not confuse this with which way the gate opens or closes. Slide the gate fully to the left. Place the first piece of RAS on top of the pinion as shown. Level the piece properly and clamp the right-hand end against the side of the gate. Screw a fastener into the first vertical slot and make sure it goes into the middle of the slot to allow for later adjustment. Join the second piece of rack onto the first. Slide the gate to the right and put a screw in the first vertical slot of the second piece. Join on and secure each subsequent piece of RAS rack in the same way, until the entire length of rack has been fitted to the side of the gate. Screw into every alternate vertical mounting slot to securely fix the rack into position. Ensure at all positions along the length of the rack it is meshing fully with the pinion. Fasten additional screws through the horizontal slots where the rack will be directly over the pinion in the open, closed, and pedestrian positions. This fixes the rack more securely in these positions when the gate starts and stops. The screw for the pedestrian position can only be drilled in when the unit is commissioned and you know where the position is. Lower the operator by 3 mm to its original position. At the same time, move the gearbox so the rack runs directly on the center line of the pinion and secure. If you're using steel rack, follow the basic procedure described for RAS rack. However, instead of screwing the rack into the side of the gate, the rack is welded into position using the small angle support brackets provided with the rack. Allow for support bracket every 300 mm. When joining two pieces of the rack together, notice how we clamp a short piece of rack across the join to keep the correct tooth spacing and ensure a reliable and quiet running gate. Check that the rack runs smoothly on the pinion along its entire length by manually sliding the gate open and closed. Finally, make sure the operator nuts are tight and seal the conduit and knockout holes with silicone to reduce the ingress of ants into the operator. Part 6. Mounting the origin marker. The origin marker is integral in the control of the operator's end of travel limits. To mount the marker, first close the gate completely. Fit the marker onto the rack at least 500 mm from the origin sensor. Note the orientation of the marker. The marker bolts directly onto the RAS rack. If you're using steel rack, mount the marker using the steel bracket provided in the kit. The bracket must be first welded to the rack and then the marker bolted to the bracket. Now open the gate until the marker is in line with the sensor and adjust the clearance between them to between 13 mm and 20 mm. It's always recommended to set the marker as close to 13 mm as possible. File away the lip on the RAS rack if this prevents you from moving the marker closer. The bracket provided for steel rack has slotted holes for easy adjustment. Now you're ready to begin the setup procedure. Part 7, setting the gate open and closed limits. Before we set up the gate limits, we need to first check that all our wiring has been done correctly. Ensure the electricity is switched off and the battery is disconnected. The main supply terminates onto this removable green connector on the side of the charger. It is recommended that the cabling and termination of the main supply is done by a qualified electrician. However, if you plan to do this yourself, ensure that it is done correctly. The live wire connects to the top terminal, the neutral wire to the middle, and the earth to the bottom. Ensure that each wire is securely tightened into the connector terminals and that no part of the wires can short against each other. The spade connector of the charger earth lead connects onto the controller here. The charger output plugs onto the controller via this white connector. The Nova plug-in receiver connects directly onto these pins on the controller and sits in the convenient receiver housing. Feed the aerial through the gap of the lid and stretch out the wire as straight as possible. This helps give the unit better range. Bend the wire so that it points down towards the bottom of the gearbox. Check that a wire link is fitted between the infrared safety beam input marked IRB on the controller and the common input marked COM. Check for a similar link between the holiday lockout input marked LCK and the common. These links will be removed if you intend using either or both of these features later. The motor wires will already be terminated onto the controller, but it's necessary to check the connection of these to suit your installation and make sure the gate runs in the right direction during commissioning. The motor is wired for a gate that closes to the right. This is viewing the gate from inside the property. The blue wire will be wired on the outside terminal. If your gate closes to the left, swap these wires. Finally, the battery leads will also be connected to the controller from the factory. Install the battery and only connect the positive lead to it. Leave the negative lead disconnected. If you're satisfied your wiring is correct, you may now switch on the electricity supply to the charger and check that the green LED marked charger lights up. You can now move on to the setup procedure. Clear the gate of any obstructions and make sure that no children or pets are playing in the vicinity, as the gate will operate during the setup procedure. To get into programming mode, remove all power from the controller. Disconnect the negative lead and unplug the charger connector. Fit the set link to the pins like this. Now reapply the power by first connecting the charger plug and then the negative lead to the battery. As you do this, the status LED will flash 5 times. When the LEDs set and L2 are on and L1 is off, you're in programming mode. The next stage is to disengage the manual override. To do this, turn the thumb wheel fully clockwise until the gate can be moved by hand. Now slide the gate approximately halfway open. Re-engage the drive by turning the thumb wheel anti-clockwise as much as possible, just short of not being able to close the manual override door. Slide the gate slightly until the drive locks with an audible click. To start the automatic setup routine, press the test button for one flash of LED L1 and then release. Then press and hold the test button until the status LED comes on. When it does, release the test button to begin the automatic setup. The gate starts to crawl open. If it disconnects the power from both the charger and battery. Your motor wires are the wrong way round and must be swapped. If the motor wires are correct, the gate will proceed with its automatic routine consisting of 5 opening and closing cycles to pick up its limit switch origin and learn its open, closed, and pedestrian positions. The automatic setup routine is shown in detail in the manual. During the last cycle, the gate reverses at full speed and stops in the pedestrian position. You can widen the pedestrian opening by shorting across the inputs marked PED and common on the terminal blocks with a short piece of wire. If you are happy with the gate setup, press and release the test button to save the settings. Your setup is complete. Get out of programming mode by removing the set link and store it over one of the 2 pins on the controller. The factory settings on the controller have been selected to suit most applications, so generally there will be no need to change the default settings. If you need to change any settings, like changing the sensitivity of the gate, refer to the section Setting Additional Features in the manual. Part 8, Remote Controls. The Nova Rolling Code remote controls must be coded into the Nova plug-in receiver. Ensure that nobody is standing in the way of the gate when you follow this procedure, as the operator is going to run. With power connected to the controller, take one of the transmitters and press and hold one of the buttons for just longer than 5 seconds. The operator will activate when this transmitter has been coded into the system. This first transmitter becomes the master and is used for coding any additional transmitters, so please mark this transmitter clearly. To add any additional transmitters, proceed as follows. Press and hold any button on the master transmitter for slightly longer than 10 seconds. As an installation hint, if you don't have a watch available, count each second allowed from 1000. For example, 1001, 1002 up to 1011. Release the button. The receiver is now in program mode and will stay in this mode for 10 seconds. Take the next transmitter, and this is important, press and release the button you want to use to operate the gate. The receiver stays in program mode for 10 seconds after each new transmitter is added. If you have no further transmitters to add, wait 10 seconds for the receiver to drop out of program mode. Test the transmitters to make sure that the coding has been done successfully. Part 9. Anti-crushing and safety beams. The Centurion D3 and D5 sliding gate operators provide excellent anti-crushing protection. The protection only activates when the gate comes into contact with the object. If the gate is opening, the gate will stop immediately, and if the gate is closing, the gate will stop and reverse. The anti-crushing sensitivity will automatically be adjusted to suit the gate. The manual provides more detail on this important feature, explaining the operation and different levels of sensitivity that can be set, should it be necessary. A safety beam is an optional extra with your operator. However, it is always recommended to provide greater safety by helping to prevent the gate closing onto an object in its path. Follow the instruction for mounting the Centurion I5 infrared beam, which is provided with the unit. However, take note of the following. 1. The beam must be active as close as possible to the side of the gate so that an object in the path of the gate is reliably detected. 2. Set the beam at the height indicated in the instructions. When wiring the safety beam to the CP80 controller, ensure that the wire link between the infrared beam input IRB and common is removed. Follow the wiring diagram provided under the section CP80 signal connection in the operator manual. Part 10, the handover. Never assume that the end user knows how to safely operate an automatic gate. Moving gates can cause serious injury and even death, so it's extremely important that the installer always explains the operation and safety requirements of the system. Ensure the user understands how to operate the manual release mechanism. When the gearbox is re-engaged, the thumb wheel must be unscrewed as much as possible, just short of not being able to close the door. Never remove the thumb wheel completely. Show how to clear the gate of obstructions and how the other safety features work. It is critical that children aren't allowed to play with the gate controls. Children and pets should always be kept well away from the gate area. Ensure the customer has a copy of the user guide and complete the commissioning check sheet in the back of the guide. The installer is the last person on the site who can ensure that the gate operator is safely installed. Please don't neglect this very important part of the installation procedure. Part 11, additional features. The Centurion D3 and D5 gate operators have a number of other features that experienced installers can make use of. For example, the operator can be programmed for 4 different modes of operation. In standard mode, that's the factory default mode, pressing a button on a remote control or intercom handset will start the gate moving. A second press will stop the gate. A third press of a button will make the gate reverse its direction of travel. Reversing mode is similar to standard mode, but instead of stopping the gate when it's moving, a press of the button causes the gate to change its direction of travel. Condominium mode is for multi-user installations. Any trigger or press of a button causes the gate to open only. Any press of a button while the gate is opening will be ignored. The auto-close function is automatically turned on and the gate will only close by this. Any press of a button while the gate is closing will reopen the gate. Pyrec mode is a high security operating mode. It operates similarly to condominium mode, but instead of waiting for the auto-close timer to close the gate closes as soon as an object has cleared the infrared beam. There are many other features that can be programmed into the gate for specific applications, so please refer to your manual for information on these. Remember, if you have any problems during your installation, please don't hesitate to contact us. Our staff are available to give you sales support, installation training, and solutions to any of your technical or installation problems. Our contact details are on the cover of your DVD and on the back page of your installation manual. Thank you for watching.